Hi, and welcome to the Ignite webcast. My name is Nanette Sperling, and I work on the Office 365 team. Ignite events are a series of technical workshops for IT pros and Microsoft partners. The Ignite webcast addresses different technical subjects and scenarios that are beneficial to anyone who wants to increase their knowledge of the Office 365 suite. Today, we're excited to have Grant Earle as our presenter, with SharePoint social features as our topic. The webcast will be about 60 minutes, and we will leave time at the end to field questions from anyone on the call. You can type your questions into the link chat box during today's presentation, and we will try to get to all of them. We ask that you please stay until the end of the call to answer some survey questions and give us your feedback on the webcast and the webcast series. We are recording today's session and we'll have a slideshow and video available online on the original Ignite blog post and on the Ignite site. One last thing, since we are recording, please understand that you may be captured in today's recording. If you do not wish to be recorded, please do not type in the IM window or please leave the meeting. So Grant, whenever you're ready.
All right, thank you very much, Nanette. And good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you may be joining from. I am Grant Earle, and a little bit about me. I am a productivity technical specialist in Orange County, California. I am very grateful for where I live because the weather here has been fantastic. Hopefully none of you on the call or listening are affected by that terrible weather down there in Atlanta, but it's pretty nice here in Orange County if you ever want to come visit. I've spent about 10 years working with SharePoint as a developer, as a consultant. I've done a lot of implementations and custom solutions, upgrades, et cetera. So I've got a lot of experience across our many different versions starting in 2001. If you do want to contact me after the webcast, my email is grant.earle@microsoft.com. If you have any trivia questions, I once attempted to win Ben Stein's money. I didn't quite win, but in this picture, I was doing all right. But I do know a little bit about trivia. But on to today's session. We're going to be talking about SharePoint Social. So the enterprise social features that we've built into the product for SharePoint 2013. And that covers SharePoint on-premises as well as SharePoint Online. And we'll start off with an overview of just what these components are, and then we'll dive into community sites. We'll look at personal site administration and what that means for SharePoint Server. We'll look at what personal sites feed offer our end users and personal site following, all the various things that we can follow in SharePoint. And we'll look at OneDrive for Business, formerly SkyDrive Pro. That announcement went out a couple of weeks ago due to some litigation with a company over in Europe. We are changing our name to OneDrive for Business. So it actually makes a lot of sense why we named it that. It might make a little bit of sense, a little bit more sense than SkyDrive Pro, but that is kind of a brand new change, and I've had to update the deck a little bit. You'll still see a little bit of mention of SkyDrive Pro, but it is now called OneDrive for Business. So just as kind of an overview, probably the most visible feature for Enterprise Social in SharePoint 2013 is the My Site Host. This is where a user will go to kind of start their day, to see what the people they're following, the sites they're following, the tags they're following, all these things they can follow, what's changed or what's been updated or any conversations or new information that's available from all of those entities. This is where they'll go, and this is their landing page for everything social in SharePoint. We can also come here to change our following status. We could administer all of the things we're following, and we can see sort of what's trending. So it's great that we follow things, but we also want to be able to see things that are trending within our company, things that we might not be thinking of that might have blown up over the last week. We can see those trending things and start to have some visibility into what those mean and how those might affect me, so we can follow those tags as well. Now, those of you that have worked with SharePoint in the past, the profile page has evolved quite a bit too, to incorporate some of this enterprise social information. And the about me is what other people see about not just who I am, like my job title, phone number, email address, office location, but it's my social profile as well that is presented to other users. So they can see, for instance, who we share in common, they can see where I fit on the org chart, and they can see the conversations and activities that I'm having with other folks or things that I'm doing on other sites or with other departments right here from this About Me page. So it's a great way to kind of see a snapshot of what someone does within an organization beyond what the organization kind of says about that person that just comes from Active Directory. So it's a very contextual, highly informative view. So let's drill into community sites. These are, if you're familiar with previous versions of SharePoint, we had discussion boards. And this is really a huge evolution of those. This is a community homepage. You'll see that it is based on a SharePoint site, and this special community template has a number of different features. The discussions kind of roll up into this one overview web part, and we can see all of the conversations. Now, what might you use a community for in SharePoint? Well, we have a lot of customers that are using them for knowledge bases, maybe a place where they can ideate or solicit new ideas. In this case, it's a marketing community. So they're just kind of sharing ideas and working together at, having a central location for all of these new ideas that might have otherwise gotten lost in these silos of email. That's sort of a very simple way to collaborate that many companies do, including Microsoft. But using communities, we can get out of those silos and bring everything together and make that searchable down the line when we're looking for topics. If someone's already brought this up, a particular marketing topic, we can leverage our enterprise search in SharePoint to mine the data so it's not lost in someone's email, especially when they leave, all that data goes with them. So these communities are really great hubs of knowledge. So we'll also see the community activity web part and the members and reputations here. And we'll do some live demos during the course of this, but let's just talk about some of the features here. One of the new things that didn't exist in the previous iterations of discussion boards in SharePoint was members and reputations. So using reputations, we can get a sense of who's really contributing to these communities, right? So we're not kind of taking someone's word for it that they're an expert. We can see exactly what they've done within this community. So we can see how many posts they've replied to. We can see, the number of posts that they've posted and their kind of value within this community that they've earned, really. It's not something that's just given to them. They've earned it. But we can also do things like the gifting of badges, too. So we've really added some nice gamification features here to where we can really encourage people to participate by offering up badges. So me as a community administrator, I can badge someone with MVP or expert or professional within this community and give their posts and replies maybe a little bit more weight, or maybe it's a contest where we can really encourage more participation, because that's ultimately what we want within SharePoint. We don't want it to become this, after the first week, people kind of take off. We want to encourage this participation, and through members, reputations, badging, et cetera, I think that we have a lot of tools at our disposal now to do that. And like I said, communities are created using this new site definition. And you can do that at the site collection and site level as well. Now, what's nice is when we create a new post within a community, we use the wiki pages infrastructure. So it's a very free form type of a post. And so we can add in some rich text, and it goes beyond just simple plain text. We have a question. Can you expose this community homepage to external visitors or only SP users? Yes, we can expose them to external users, but they need to be authenticated. So in an extranet scenario, we could certainly do that. And like Daryl said, using SP Online, it's only for internal. So thank you for that, Daryl. And another important consideration is that every community site is self-contained. So those reputations and badges and posts do not translate into other communities. So they're kind of their own islands, which is good because, if we have a marketing or IT community, that information is not necessarily going to translate across those boundaries. Because if I'm an expert in IT, I'm probably not going to be an expert in marketing. We've also introduced categories for our communities too, because as we launch maybe a marketing community and it becomes active, we're going to want to create categories, postings to the community, or else it's going to be very difficult for us to find what we're looking for. Enterprise search is great, but let's just say we're trying to browse through our community posting or our community. It's much easier when we've got categories assigned. Like I said before, the presentation pages are wiki pages for that rich content. We also are using the rating and liking infrastructure for our postings. And so that just gives you more tools at your disposal to sort or to bubble up the most important content. And this also ties into our other social capabilities like our newsfeed. So when I like content, when I join a community, that's all going to be reflected within the newsfeed that we'll see in a moment. Some other specific features, I mentioned reputation, moderation. So we have tools at our disposal to enable users to report offensive or inappropriate content. We have best replies. So if I'm asking a question within an IT knowledge base community and I get 50 answers, but there's one that really cuts to the chase and tells me how to broadcast my HDMI from my Lenovo, then I can mark that as the best reply, and that's going to be pinned to the top of that posting. So as someone looking at that same question further down the line, they don't have to scroll down 50 replies. That best reply is pinned right to the top. So it's very, very useful. And again, we'll see this in action in a few minutes. Here's what categories look like. So I can define categories as a community moderator, and then my users within the community can assign their posts to these various categories, and those will be reflected in the category page of the community. Okay, so this is what posting looks like. Every post can be edited and deleted by the original owner as well as the community owners or moderators. Right, so that's important from a moderation standpoint that and from an user standpoint that if the question is no longer relevant, I as the original poster can go back and delete that. Also, as a moderator, I can mark a post as featured, and so that is also a way to get content sticking to the top of our community, because as these communities mature, we'll want to make sure that relevant content or timely content can be posted or pinned at the top. All right, so the best reply, looks like I got ahead of myself a little bit, but the best reply, you'll see here that Alex marked Pavel's answer as the best reply over the 57 other responses that he got. So that best information from Pavel the expert is right next to Alex's question within the community. Okay, so the ratings model, we can enable this again to be able to assign either stars or likes. Right? So as a moderator, I can say that I'd like to have either a 1 to 5 stars, or as a user, I can like, and that kind of ties into the rest of the social infrastructure and the way that we like other things in SharePoint that we'll see in a moment. So I can track my reputation as well, and there's a membership hub within the community that lets me kind of personally track what I've done, what I need to do to get to the next level, or what I need to do to earn a badge, right? And me as a community owner, I control each activity's points, so I can say that for every new post that someone creates, that someone gets 1 point. Replying to a post, I can weight that a little higher. And getting a best reply, I can weight that the highest and earn more points that's directly attributed to my reputation within that community. So it's a very granular way for the community owners to really tune how reputation settings work. Okay. Looks like there's kind of a referring to external sharing. Hey, Patrick, you should be able to share up to 10,000 external users. Yes, that's absolutely true, but they won't necessarily be authenticated for communities. So that is a good point. Using partner access licenses in SharePoint Online, we can share with up to 10,000 external users, but for communities, they won't have the user profiles necessary to participate. All right, community badges. There are two types of badges in communities, achieved and gifted. Achieved is, like we were looking at earlier, when a community moderator sets those point values for things like replying, creating a post, etc. Those are achieved. And then gifted badges are what I deem it's basically an award that's assigned by a community owner. So you see Pavel over here has this gifted badge of expert, and I can choose any name that I want, or as many as I want to. So he can be an expert, he can be an MVP, he can be a superstar, rock star, you name it. So again, earning badges is a lot like earning points for your reputation. We can either choose the point threshold method, and then once they choose that specific level, they receive that badge that shows that particular achievement. So gifted badges are a way for those owners, again, to push that recognition to a member, and it has nothing to do with achievement. And it's completely arbitrary. So you don't necessarily have to participate at all to be gifted a badge, right? So it's again going back to that gamification and encouraging users. We want to encourage users to participate in our community, and this is just another tool in our tool belt. So people will see that there are achieved badges, gifted badges, and human nature. We have people that want to achieve things, so it's a great way to encourage that participation again. So this is the membership page that I was talking about earlier. This is where I can see all the members within this community that I'm a member of, and also my membership as well. So they can see their own status and see what's needed to get to that extra level, to be that super high achiever within the community. Okay, so if we do have inappropriate content, there are ways for the community to self-police, and we can allow our users to report things to a moderator, and then me as a moderator, I can see, you know, it's very convenient. I have a consolidated view of all of those posts that have been requested for moderation, and I can either approve or deny those too. But it's just a great way to kind of enable that self-policing so that you're not kind of on the hook for doing that yourself. See, we have a nice little sidebar discussion about external sharing in SharePoint Online. I like that. If towards the end we still have some of those questions, I can go into that as well. All right, the community portal. Now, this is basically, it's a directory of communities within your organization. And as marketing creates communities, IT creates communities, sales and marketing has their communities, this is a way to aggregate all of those communities into a single portal. So that, you know, for an end user, someone that wants to participate or see what's going on with various communities, this is a one-stop shop. So it's a great kind of unifying place for all of this social content. And so this is actually a site collection that's provisioned through central administration. All right, so finally, let's go take a look at a community. Let me go ahead and share my desktop now. Might take a couple of seconds. And in SharePoint Online, you don't have to obviously provision this through central administration. This will be provisioned for you. I'm assuming that people are able to see my presentation. Looks like a few of you are still waiting. But I'll go ahead and move over to our community hub here. So hopefully everyone can see this now. And so again, this is that one-stop shop for all of my communities and all of my social content within those communities, right? So you'll see that we have various departments, various types of communities, everything from knowledge bases to discussion forums around general marketing topics. So you have any? All right. Yes. Thank you, Daryl. All right. Lon's got it too. Terrific. So let's drill into one of these communities. Let's go into IT. And just going back real quick, we see from this portal site, you know, exactly what's going on within all of these communities too. So it's not just listing the communities, but it's listing the activity too. So we can see the, you know, the hottest communities. So IT is relatively active here. We've got 14 members, 10 discussions, 31 replies. Not bad in our small example company here. So it's got some participation. And now we see our community landing page here. Now I'm a moderator, so I see my community tools here, but an end user is also going to see what's happening here, right? So it's going to see the number of members, the number of discussions, number of replies, and then we're going to be able to see the top contributors. So this gamification of communities really encourages people to, you know, get that top contributor spot. Because if we mouse over Pavel, we You see Pavel's reputation here based on his what he's done within this community. You see what Katie's done, Aziz, et cetera. So these are the cream of the crop within this community. They've been the most active. All right, so now if we look through some of our discussions, we see just kind of an abstract of what the posting is, you know, typical discussion board stuff. But let's take a look at Dorina's question about tablet PCs be issued next month, because I have a question about that too. So I need some new hardware. So Dorina is asking about the email about the tablet PC request to replace some of the old laptops. And has it been confirmed? Well, there have been a few different replies, but Dorina went in and marked Aziz as having the best reply. So his answer is going to be pinned to the top here, and that lets me save a lot of time from, instead of scrolling through this entire topic, I can just see the most relevant answer. All right, so this is also really valuable because in our enterprise search in SharePoint, these best replies will automatically display with the social search results as that pinned answer as well. So even if I'm not in the community, I can still leverage this valuable information and these answers right from my search page. So going back here to the landing page, let's quickly take a look at the members, the membership here for our community. Okay, we've got quite a few different members here, and at a glance, we can see exactly what they've done. Within the community, we see Aziz, again, has that best reply that I just saw. So everyone's doing a pretty good job. But then my membership, I just joined. My alter ego is David. And my membership, I really need to turn it on here because I haven't done anything. So I need to really fix my reputation score, and because I want to keep working in the IT department. So I need to start answering some questions. All right, so that's membership. Let's go and assign some badges, because it looks like Pavel and Aziz have really done a great job. So how do we do that? Click on assign badges. Go to Pavel. And we can moderate here. And all of this under the covers is using standard SharePoint lists. So if you do want to extend like the badging infrastructure, there's no reason why you couldn't do that. All right, trying to get my ribbon going here. Okay, come on, ribbon. All right, well, for some reason, my ribbon is not cooperating with me here in the community, but what I was going to do was basically assign a gifted badge to Aziz and Pavel and show you how we can also create badges very easily as well. So we'll come back to that in a bit. And if we go to categories here, we can also see that that I've created some categories for my users. We've got one anyway. And we can create additional categories here. And what I really like about creating categories is that, you know, we saw the general one. It's kind of boring. It's a tile. But what I can do is actually create a new category and assign a category picture to give it some visual impact as well. So we'll create a PC refresh category. So people are asking questions about manufacturers, are asking questions about all kinds of PC refresh specific things, and we want to be able to separate that out. Save that, and then we'll go back to our categories page and refresh that. And now we've got a category. And what's also kind of nice about this is the fact that, one, it's touch friendly, and two, I can mouse over this or touch this tile and see what's going on specifically within that category. So it's a great way to slice and dice all of the information within just this specific community. Okay, so let's go back to our deck here. Let's switch it back to PowerPoint. Okay, personal site administration. We saw earlier, just briefly, and we'll dive into a live demo of this in just a couple of minutes, but when we're sharing content about ourselves and we're participating in conversations, we're following things, there are some privacy, some ways to administer the privacy of our users and to give them that option too. Like before in user profiles back in 2010 and before, this is all administered through the user profile service application in central admin. And of course, now I'm talking only about on-premises because we don't have access to central administration in SharePoint Online. But within SharePoint server, this is all done through the user profile service application. And administrators can, like they always have, govern profile information that users can or cannot manage. So for instance, we don't want users to manage their office location because that'll typically come from AD, but we do want them to manage things like their alma mater or their hometown, things like that, if we choose to expose those properties through our About Me page. And some of the simplifications compared to 2010, one of those is the privacy setting is now only me or everyone. It's not only me, everyone, colleagues, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We made it binary, so only me or everyone. So it's much, much simpler. We don't have to worry about explaining those various levels. So going back to that privacy implication when I'm sharing or following through the SharePoint portal, we can enable that so that other users can automatically see that, or we can leave it as the default, which says that we do not share that information with anyone else. So people will be able to see things like the conversations that we participate in, but not necessarily all of the other social things that we do, like posting on a note board, updating my Ask Me About, you know, updating my profile information. All of that will be kept private. So let's look at our personal site fleet feeds and kind of how our microblogging flows. All right, so we have user-generated and system-generated. Right, so the user-generated is going to be me participating in a conversation, and the system-generated is going to be, you know, the fact that I participated in a conversation. So the system is going to say that I posted in a community or I replied to a post, whereas I'm going to say, you know, a specific reply to a conversation or I'll start a conversation. And all of this flows into either the public microfeed or the private microfeed. And what we'll be looking at is the public microfeed for all intents and purposes today. So all of this microfeed and microblogging, where does that come from? Well, it comes from our SharePoint in cache memory, so the distributed cache service is where all of this information is coming from, with the exception of the user's activities in the About Me. Right, so that is not retrieved from the cache, but everything else will be. So by virtue of it being cached, users can always see their latest activities when they go to that feed in their My Site, and we'll take a look at that in just a minute. So we've talked a lot about users' feeds, but we also have a site feed. Right? So we don't necessarily have to talk to the whole company. Right? So I don't have to post a question about marketing to the entire company. I can post that question specifically to the marketing site that I want to have answer that question, and only the members of that site will be privy to that information or to that discussion. All right, so it gives me a way to fence in and scope my conversations, so we're not always conversing with the entire company or even the people that are following us. Okay, liking. Liking is big in SharePoint 2013 because liking is going to tell SharePoint what it is that we're interested in and what we want to see. So when I come to my newsfeed in the morning, I want to see posts from Molly, Zrinka, Andy, and Tom. And, you know, I'm not so interested in posts from the folks in the facilities department because that has no bearing on my job. But I do want to maybe follow the sites of the R&D department, and I want to like certain documents so that I'll be able to easily keep track of those sites and easily keep track of all of those entities from my page, from my site. And all of these activities from the things we're following and liking will show in that main consolidated feed part. We also have sort of the typical social networking things that you're used to in maybe Facebook or Twitter, where we have at mentions, right? So I can pull people into my conversations using at mentions, and I can directly mention that person, and it's actually independent from following, and so that person that's maybe not following my conversation still see that conversation when I at mention them on their feed. And you'll see here that when we do the at mention, it actually looks up the person as we're typing. So it's a nice type ahead feature where I don't have to know their exact alias or name, and I can choose the person. If I have 100 Alexes, I can easily see the Alex that I want. And then once I do at mention someone, they'll get emailed saying, hey, you were at mentioned by Don, and go check out this conversation. So people aren't beholden to checking their news feed all the time. Maybe someone is working more in Outlook and they're checking their email a bit more. This is a nice way to pull them into that social conversation that you're having. So the everyone view, maybe I'm not following certain folks, but I want to kind of see what's going on in the rest of the company. Using the everyone view, I can see all of those user-generated activities from the rest of the company. So that's nice. If maybe I'm looking for people to follow, I'm new to the company, and I need to kind of get a bird's eye view of what's going on. So if you're thinking about rolling out some of these social feeds, some of the news feeds and the My Sites, some farm topology considerations for you, we do recommend having a single user profile application versus multiple, because if you don't, then you're going to see a bit of a delay in the notifications, because using that single UPA is going to be much faster in terms of the cache. Community sites will need to live in the same farm where your My Site host is. Because if not, then you won't see community notifications in the news feed. So community notifications are, you know, you'll recall we were just in that community. If I start a new topic or if I like a post or if I have a best reply, I won't see that in the news feed if the community is not in the same farm. So just something to be aware of and to remember if you've got a large farm or multiple farms. I promise there are some demos coming very quickly. Let's just get through a couple more slides so you have kind of some context into what I'll be showing. People following. Where can I follow people? I can follow people from my people search through the enterprise search capability in SharePoint. I can follow people from my news feed. So if I see a conversation where one of the people I am following is chatting with someone I'm not following and I think that person's very insightful, I can follow them right from there. Or I can follow them from the About Me page or their profile page. So lots of different entry points there. I can also follow sites, and we'll see my favorite sites page in a minute, but I can follow sites from search, like if there's a contextual result for the term that I searched for, I can follow directly from that search result in my sneak peek here. I can follow from the community portal. And we saw that page where we aggregated all of our communities. I can follow the site, the community site directly from there, or from the site itself. Up in the ribbon, we'll see for every site there's a follow with a star, and that's where we can follow our site. Following documents. Again, we can do that through search. We can do that from our document library. And then tags. So enterprise social, we have, again, some of those familiar features that you've used in LinkedIn, Twitter, Facebook, where we have hashtags that kind of give you that ability to add metadata or, you know, just kind of tie things together on a particular subject, right? So when you start to see those hashtags, you can follow those and follow that topic as it's discussed throughout the organization. And we can follow those tags in the newsfeed, in the user profile of someone that's been following certain tags, in the tag profile. So when we have a site with many tags, we can see kind of the tag cloud and follow the tag from there, or from the trending tags web part. And that's a really cool web part because it lets us see what's hot and what's being discussed that we might not be following. And this is not my favorite slide because it's kind of like, okay, it's just a very small web part from the newsfeed page, and demo's much better. But anyway, I'm following gives me a snapshot of everything that I'm following from those various entities we just discussed, people, documents, sites, and tags. And then we can drill in to this as well. So we click on these particular types of things I'm following and see a cloud of all of those things. Finally, we get to another demo. Now let's share my desktop again. Wait a few seconds for that to share out. See, a couple of you have it. I'll just go ahead and switch over now. All right, so this is my newsfeed, and with SharePoint 2013, or in my case, Office 365 and SharePoint Online, we have this sweet bar at the top, And this is going to give us just a unifying navigation between SharePoint and my newsfeed and my OneDrive / SkyDrive, my favorite sites and my profile, etc. So I clicked on newsfeed in this case, and my alter ego, David here, has been very busily participating in quite a few conversations. And he's also been following a few things too, right? So again, this is that little part that I showed you in the slide earlier. It shows the people I'm following, the documents I'm following, the sites and the tags. And then I love this, the trending tags, which lets me see all the things that I might not be following. So I can see that, looks like Marketing Excellence Awards, that's been heating up. We've got an awards ceremony coming up. So the marketing team has been busily discussing that topic. And I've actually been in there too. But you'll notice that the news looks a lot like some of the other social networks you might have participated on. And we didn't want to reinvent the wheel here, so we made it familiar. We made it the threaded conversation view. We gave you the at mentions, the hashtags. And let's do just a demo of Garth. So we get lookups on both people with at mentions and with our tags, with our hashtags here. So Garth will get an email, and this conversation will also show on Garth's own newsfeed as well. Now let's say I found a nifty video, and I want to, you know, this is great, the newsfeed, but it's kind of, you know, what if I want to collaborate on a document, or I want to embed a video or embed a site? Well, we can do that. So we can say, we can either do this with external content from, let's say, YouTube, or with internal assets as well. So videos directly from an asset library in SharePoint. We can also do this with Word documents, Excel documents, PowerPoints, where we embed the document directly in the conversation so that it's not like, you know, a case of you kind of telling everyone to manually navigate away. No, we can do a contextual collaboration, unstructured collaboration right here in the newsfeed. So it's really, really quite rich. We can also embed photos. And so this is my feed for everyone that I'm following, but if I want that bird's eye view of everyone within the organization, I click on everyone. I can see who's mentioned me with some at mentions. So if someone's really trying to get a hold of me, I can see that. I can see all of the likes that I've made in the last certain period of time. So very, very rich. And then if I go to my About Me page, I can see what other people are presented with when they come and look me up, either if they arrive here via people search or they click on my name directly within a conversation. This is the page that they're going to see. And then I can, I have a nice self-service capability where I can edit this profile here and edit the, edit my bio, edit all of the profile properties that my admin has allowed me to. So very rich, shows me all of my activities for someone that isn't following me yet, so they can make that decision whether or not it makes sense to follow me. All right, we're quickly running out of time here. We have about 10 minutes, so we've got a few more slides, and let me go ahead and share the presentation again. So OneDrive for Business. This is by far the feature that I personally use the most in SharePoint 2013. Probably the most valuable for me personally. You know, anyone that's ever lost a laptop and lost weeks worth of work and presentations and you name it, OneDrive is really for you. 25 gigabytes if you're a SharePoint Online subscriber, and then on premises you can determine how much you want to give to your users, but sort of the baseline that we offer today in SharePoint Online is 25 gigs. And this is all storage that's managed through SharePoint. So you can choose how you want to roll that out and to what extent. But basically, OneDrive for Business provides that single place for users to create, share, collaborate, and follow documents. So this is where I start my day, where I put all of my work, and that's synced up with SharePoint, and it's synced back down to my desktop. So I don't necessarily have to work in SharePoint to work with OneDrive, right? Because I have that location within Windows Explorer, as well as that cloud location as well. So be it private cloud, public cloud, it's very, very flexible. And what it really consists of is a single document library that's my private document library. It's part of my site, my personal site. And what's the other thing that's nice is that I don't have to email documents out anymore to the people that I work with. I simply share a link directly from OneDrive in either SharePoint or on my desktop, and that link then goes to the person that I'm sharing with, and I can easily choose the permissions, either edit or view, without having to know the whole SharePoint permission structure. So we've simplified that and made sharing much easier. So again, we have the offline capability as well. You see here in this little in this screenshot that it's right within your favorite places here in Windows Explorer. And we also have an agent that sits in your tray that is responsible for syncing those docs back and forth. So if you're offline, you can say work on an airplane, and then when you connect back up to your network, it'll automatically sync back up to SkyDrive for you. So it's a great way to work on the road, which I do all the time. So it's really nice. All right, one last demo. Let's do this. So you see right next to my newsfeed is my SkyDrive, soon to be OneDrive. We've already changed that internally at Microsoft, but we'll be changing that publicly very soon. So this is my OneDrive. This is where I sort of start my day. And one thing that I really like to show, well, first I need to share my desktop out. Hey, Dean, I see your question there. It is going to look a little weird, but I don't think that that's what it's going to look like. I don't think it's going to say OneDrive for Business. I think it's going to say SkyDrive at organization name. So I'll show you what mine looks like when I finally am able to share my desktop again with you. Because I have multiple SkyDrives synced up myself, including a SkyDrive consumer. So that's another important consideration while we're waiting for my desktop to share, is that SkyDrive and SkyDrive Pro are two separate entities, as are OneDrive and OneDrive for Business, the new names. So OneDrive is our consumer-based service, whereas OneDrive for Business is our enterprise equivalent of that, so of that personal file sharing. All right, finally my desktop is shared. Let me quickly go to my OneDrive / SkyDrive folder, or my OneDrive SkyDrive document library. And what I'm going to do is show you how easy it is, one, just to add documents. So let's go ahead, and what I'm going to do now is just drag this document over. And so if you blinked, you might have missed that. But basically what I did was I simply drag and drop a document directly to my library in SharePoint without having to do, you know, five clicks, upload document, browse, you find the document, okay. And then, you know, it's, so I've streamlined, or we have streamlined the process just for getting the content into my OneDrive, which is fantastic. Now, if I want to sync this back to my desktop, what I want to do is I come up here and I click on this sync button, and that's going to allow me to create that connection with my OneDrive in the cloud. And I'll sync now. Getting ready to sync. And I'll go ahead and show my files. And here's my, here it is. It's all cached. We see this little green icon, meaning that everything is cached back to my local machine. So I have a local copy that's synced up with the cloud. And it's just very simple for me to, let's see if I can get some content in there for you. Okay, we'll close this dialog. Just copy a document in there. A very fun looking licensing document. So I'll go ahead and paste that, and we'll see that it's syncing now. And then once we see that green icon, we can come back to our cloud version, and we'll see the document there as well. But again, it's a great place, instead of working on things entirely on my desktop or in a file share, for me to have my information in one place. And we can come back to our document library, and we'll see that fun licensing document here. And now let's say I want to share that. I can easily share it with, let's invite my friend Garth. Garth Fort. I want Garth to edit this because I want him to do a little bit of my work for me. Please make some changes. I'll hit share. Now Garth is going to get an email, and in that email will be a link to this document where he can actually see my library with all of the documents that he has access to. So there we have it, kind of a whirlwind trip through SharePoint Social. Let's go back to our presentation really quick. Got about 2 minutes, and I'll just wrap up. But if there are any questions now.
Thanks, Grant. I am going to go ahead and post some survey questions for folks. If you wouldn't mind answering those, it's always helpful for us to improve. And I'll let Grant answer any questions in the IM window. Thanks.
All right. Daryl's got a question about Yammer versus